What happened to Citigroup? Was there a disconnect between what Mike Corbat wanted to have happen and what actually happened?
I think Mike Corbat less wanted a boring year, but would have been fine with a boring year. It turned out to be less boring for Citi for many other reasons, including the fact that Citi failed the Fed stress tests on the qualitative side. Not the capital side, but the perhaps more important side when the Fed looks at your ability to, you know, how you plan to return capital to shareholders, for example, and whether you've really got a solid handle on the risks that your business faces. And on that front, the Fed gave Citi a failing grade. Mike Corbat is still dealing with the fallout of the fraud scandal in Mexico. Citigroup paid among the largest fines to the Justice Department. Now, Bank of America and JP Morgan and others have also paid massive fines, but on that level as well, it was hardly a boring year for Mike Corbat.
Yeah, at the same time, Mike Mayo of CLSA has turned bullish on Citigroup. He's been a longtime critic of the bank. He's now saying it's safer now under Michael Corbat than it has been under the predecessors. Is that a view where he's on his own? Is an isolated view, Michael? Do you know?
I think there are others that share that view. I mean, you know, there's a few different elements of this. There is the capital side. Citi's obviously a much stronger bank than it was 5 or 6 years ago.
So on the balance sheet side.
Right. On the balance sheet side, they've done a lot. They've done things to simplify the business, like these sales of the consumer operations, scaling back the number of countries they're in. It makes it a little less complex, but still, it's a very complex thing, a very, very complex bank, and the risks are out
there. Here's the thing. You can't have everything that the regulators are imposing upon Citigroup. You can't have Basel III, you can't have Dodd-Frank, you can't have the Financial Stability Board demanding a capital surcharge of at least 2 percentage points. You can't have a leverage ratio, you can't have a total loss absorbing capacity, the newest wrinkle that the regulators have thrown into the mix, and expect the bank to be boring and profitable at the same time.
Right.
So on the one hand, let's say you're Elizabeth Warren, you might look at what Citigroup is doing and say to yourself, oh, that's bad. Citigroup is doing more of what it did before the financial crisis. But on the other hand, you can be a Mike Mayo and say, well, of course, yes, okay, Citigroup is perhaps taking on risk, taking on more risk than some people like Elizabeth Warren might like, but it's got an enormous capital buffer to protect taxpayers in the event of a calamity. And in the meantime, that's in theory what Mike Corbat needs to do more of in order to generate a return to accumulate capital that he can ultimately give back to shareholders and make it worthwhile to own the stock in the first place.
Well, they're not getting a dividend, that's for sure.
Right. And he, you know, he wants it to not be boring in the sense that they're doing big deals and making big profits, but not in the sense that they're failing.
And he, like other people, smells opportunity in places like Europe.
Right.
European banks are being forced to shrink their balance sheets. European banks are going to be responsible for far less of the credit that ultimately the European economy will need to regenerate. And
I mean,
what's going to come in its place, right? Capital markets. And Citigroup, like Goldman Sachs and Morgan Stanley and JP Morgan and Bank of America, want to be there to satisfy that capital market need. And if you're going to do that,
well, you know,
you have to have a trading
who's backing them in those capital. The question about who's backing
Corey,
them in those capital
I forgot
markets
about
is,
you, Corey.
Really? Eric, really?
Yes,
after all this?
Corey,
look,
really?
I think the thing that really set Elizabeth Warren off was the last-minute budget act that was to keep the government from a shutdown. Citigroup's lobbyists encouraged them to slip in this piece of legislation that created a new government backstop for swaps trading. It was a fairly amazing thing, and her ire was, well, listen to what she had to say when she talked about why Dodd-Frank wasn't what it was supposed to be.
You know, there's a lot of talk lately about how Dodd-Frank isn't perfect. There's a lot of talk coming from Citigroup about how Dodd-Frank isn't perfect. So let me say this to anyone who is listening at Citi. I agree with you. Dodd-Frank isn't perfect. It should have broken you into pieces.
So maybe at the end of 2014, we have the vampire squid has moved to the back seat, and Citigroup is a poster child for sort of bad behavior and government bailouts on Wall Street.
Well, Michael, what do you think of that statement?
Well, I think there is definitely still a view out there in D.C. that some of these banks should be broken up. And, you know, Citigroup is perhaps the most complex to break up. It's the hardest to break up because it's so tied to its network of different countries.
I don't think we can blame Citi or any of the other banks for acting in a self-interested manner. That's what they're going to do. That's what they feel they have
to do.
It's fiduciaries, right?
Yes.